Hello, environmental science students. Welcome back to the next chapter. We are going to be talking about air pollution and kind of an interesting time to be talking about this, considering the coronavirus pandemic has really caused a lot of people to stay at home lately. And we're seeing some very drastic effects out there in terms of air pollution. I wanted to start the chapter off by showing you this photo of Delhi, the city of Delhi, India, typically known as one of the most polluted air in the world. Their city is pretty bad in terms of air pollution. So on the left before the lockdown and on the right is afterwards. So we have some crazy drastic effects. I left a link down here as well in the PowerPoint, which I'll upload to my WLC. You can go and look at some more of these photos of some of these really drastic differences. So we'll talk a little bit about that. So what are the key ideas for this chapter? Well, this first lecture is really going to focus on the key idea number one. Identifying the major types of air pollutants and where they come from. We'll also talk about photochemical smog. So smog is something that actually produces through a photochemical process. And then acids, how they're actually produced inside rain clouds. We'll talk a little bit about the control and prevention of the pollution, talk about the ozone depletion and indoor air pollution as well, especially in developing countries where they have to use cook stoves, for example, in not ventilated areas, things like that. So first key idea, we'll talk about this one right here, number one. So what is air pollution? Well, in general, it can be chemicals, actual physical particles, or also microorganisms. All three can contribute. And we're talking about concentrations in the atmosphere that are high enough to actually harm life and also buildings and ecosystems in general. So plants, animals, and buildings and ecosystems. So that's a general idea of what air pollution is. And this is another piece I wanted to show really quick. And it shows the air pollution quality in America. This is an article that I pulled up earlier, and it shows March 2000 or January 2020 and March. So this is looking at nitrogen dioxide. NO2 is a good indicator of general air pollution. So notice these big hotspots down here. This is Los Angeles. Deep red showing more, and it pretty much disappears now versus last year. There's Chicago, and then a lot on the East Coast, New York. See that red hotspot just kind of disappear. So some really interesting articles that talk about these stark differences between just over a matter of a month of people staying home, the drastic difference we see from last year to what it is right now. So pretty interesting. So we're going to talk about air pollutants in the scheme of the globe. So yeah, that's what's interesting about air pollutants is if you your country produces them, they go up into the atmosphere and can travel across the globe. So we have this kind of shared global air system that we all have to kind of take care of the best we can because we're all polluting our everybody's air at the same time. This is a photo from, oh, I forget what city. This is somewhere in China. And you'll see this is not pandemic masks. This is typical cloth masks or other masks. A lot of people in other countries wear masks to help mitigate some of those air pollution problems. It's really unhealthy to be breathing in this stuff if your city has a lot of it. So what are the major air pollutants? Well, this is just a list. We're going to go through the details of these. Sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides, carbon oxides, and just straight up physical particulates. And then other volatile organic compounds, the ozone compound, and then lead and mercury, some of these metals, and get up in the atmosphere. So here are the actual details from the book. I've chopped up this table in half to actually look at this a little bit more in detail to zoom in a little bit better. So where did my laser pointer go? Here we are. So if we look at some of these first ones, we're starting with sulfur dioxide. And you notice these are human-derived sources that we're talking about. Most of them, not all of them, but combustion of fuels is a big one for a lot of the pollutants that we're going to be talking about. So where it comes from, SO2, coal, oil, gasoline, things like that. So they contain sulfur, and SO2 is a byproduct of that. Effects and impacts you can hear over here. A lot of it is respiratory irritants for a lot of these. So it can harm also plants. And this is part of the ones that convert to acids in the atmosphere. Nitrogen oxide, so those were really what we're looking at on those net maps before. And it comes from all combustion types, not just human-derived sources, but it's a pretty good indicator of just air pollution in general. So in those city hotspots, you see that this amount went way down after the stay-at-home orders went into effect. This is also a respiratory irritant, and it can also convert to nitric acid. It also helps with the photochemical smog process. By helps, I mean contributes to that in a bad way. Carbon monoxide, this actually, so CO2, carbon dioxide, is something that we see as a byproduct of combustion. But if you have incomplete combustion, as in you don't have enough oxygen, you can actually have carbon monoxide as a byproduct. We just actually learned about this in general chemistry. We're looking at hydrocarbons right now. So typically CO2 is the main contributor to the emissions from combustion, but these are poorly ventilated cooking fires or exhaust systems in our cars can malfunction. So we also produce a lot of this. This is really toxic to humans. It bonds to our hemoglobin, our iron transport slash storage protein in our body, and interferes with the oxygen transport. So, sorry, not iron transport. The iron is inside the hemoglobin and it transports oxygen and binds to oxygen. So those are the first three. What else do we have here? Well, in general, just particulate matter. So these are really small particles that we can't really see individually, but when you burn things, some of that stuff just gets kicked up into the atmosphere, the byproducts, or other things, construction, dust, kicking up dust from the road just from driving. So a lot of our cars produce a lot of this just from driving around. And there's a lot of different problems with this type of particulate matter. And this is where you actually see that a lot of the visibility comes into play. This contributes to those hazy kind of atmospheres where the light bounces off these particles, and you can actually physically see that in the air if there's enough of it. Lead, thankfully, isn't as big of a problem as it used to be, but this used to be a gasoline additive, and also old paints have this in them. Coal as well could be a source of lead, and this is really bad for especially developing children. Ozone is a very interesting one, O3, and it's a secondary pollutant. We're going to talk about that as well. It's formed by sun and water, so sunlight is the actual energy source for this reaction. And this is a very reactive compound. It's if you have put plastics in the presence of this, you'd see them just kind of deteriorate. It reacts with stuff very quickly. And then some other air pollutants, VOCs or volatile organic compounds. This is a very large class. So anytime you see something evaporate, so like acetone on a lab bench, fuels, gasoline, paints, any type of that evaporating into the air, those are volatile compounds that now go up into the atmosphere. And that can be a precursor to forming ozone, which is very dangerous. Mercury as well, this is really from mining and some coal sources, oil. There can be some of those dissolved metals in there. And this is where we talked to mercury a lot. It bioaccumulates in the food chain. And then carbon dioxide, that's combustion. So combustion fossil fuels or burning forests, things like that. We've talked about CO2 quite a bit. So particulate matter, just this is a good way of showing this. So what is particulate matter again? Well, it comes from a lot of natural sources and a lot of unnatural sources. So volcanoes, wood fumes, just fires in general, power plants, cars with their vehicle exhaust and kicking up road dust, all this contributes to these small particles. These have been blown up by 500 times to give you a scale. So they range between 0.01 micrometers, and this is 500 times what it the size of it actually is. And again, this 10 micrometer size is five blown up 500 times to show you just the relative size of some of these particles. So those are really small particles that we can breathe into our lungs, and it's really not good for us. And the sun hits this and it scatters light from the sun or it absorbs it. So it can block the sun. And it kind of has this hazy look to it. And we can see that haze. So we didn't really distinguish between primary and secondary when we went through this list, but we're going to do that next. So two classes, primary and secondary. In figure 10.3, we're going to look at that relationship between the two. So primary, these are just think of directly out of a combustion source or an exhaust pipe, or you burn a fire and you just boom, they go into the atmosphere. These are carbon oxides, sulfur oxides, and nitrogen oxides, and pretty much most of those particulate matters. So that's the primary stuff that goes up into the atmosphere. The secondary pollutants are transformed in the sky. So the sunlight is the energy source, water is one of the reactants, oxygen or other compounds, and you form things like ozone, sulfates, and nitrates. So this is the figure that I alluded to before. So here are all the primary ones from just volcanoes, cars, power plants, wood fires, particulate matter from exhaust, etc., all that stuff. So most of the suspended particles, and then most of all, almost all the hydrocarbons, CO, CO2, all this stuff, volatile organic compounds, sulfur oxides, then they can go over to these. So SO2 can get converted to SO3. We have hydrocarbons getting converted to H2SO4. We have NO2 getting, and the nitrous oxides getting converted to nitric acid, HNO3. So we've got these really reactive compounds over here. Ozone, this comes from this to go to this. Then we get our secondary pollutants. We are going to be talking a lot more about ozone and the acids in the later sections of the chapter. So, but this is how they get to that point. And then they have bad effects once they get to those components. The other big point this chapter is making is that it's not just from humans. So it comes from natural sources and human sources. There are plenty of natural sources of air pollution. So it's not just humans producing that. It comes from both. So some of the natural sources, you can think of forest fires, lightning coming down and creating this, plants themselves. Plants are giving off different volatile organic compounds that are just in their plant material. We have, this is like the, I forget if this is the Blue Ridge or the Smoky Mountains, that area of the United States kind of got that name because you've got this kind of blue smoky haze in these natural valleys from all the plants. So this is, a natural kind of smoggy haze. Volcanoes too, it's a big source of natural air pollution. We classify human pollution by the word anthropogenic. I think we used this in a previous chapter, but I can't remember. Probably from our human waste chapter, but it comes from human and genesis created. So human created air pollution, anthropogenic is what we're going to be using for that. And this, we've looked through quite a few of these already. On-road vehicles, so vehicles that are being driven, power plants themselves, industrial processes, so industrial plants that have byproducts that are volatile to get in the atmosphere, and also just simply waste disposal in general can produce these types of air pollution. This is data from the EPA showing up to what year is this? I don't know exactly what year this is, but we can still look at relative values here. So this is millions of metric tons of this type of waste. And for example, carbon monoxide, where does that come from? Mostly from on-road vehicles is what we find. So mostly the carbon monoxide comes from exhaust issues in our vehicles. The combustion process isn't perfect, and instead of producing just CO2, we also produce carbon monoxide that comes out of our vehicles. Nitrogen oxides, again, most of that comes from on-road vehicles, but also a lot comes from electricity generation, so those power plants, and just in general fossil fuel combustion. So a lot of different ways this finds its way to the atmosphere. Sulfur dioxide really mostly comes from electricity generation. And then particulate matter, you can check that out here. Road dust is the biggest contributor. So just vehicles driving, kicking up dust. There's also a lot of different processes, just in terms of miscellaneous, there's a lot of different ways dust gets created. Forest, just fires in general, residential wood combustion, so using that to your homes. A lot of different ways particulates gets into the atmosphere. So this is the ways it breaks down. Again, these are all anthropogenic. These are human produced, human produced fires, human produced wood combustion, etc. And what else do I want to say about that? I was curious what these looked like in the current time, but we're going to look at some more graphs here anyway. So I have another update I want to show you. This is percentage difference from air quality standard. So they basically, the EPA has a percent standard that they give. For example, carbon monoxide, like a national standard that they think is like, this is what we're going to compare our current air quality to. So the being below this is better, being above it is worse. You don't want to be above the standard. You'd rather be much below the standard. So in 1990, you'll notice ozone was quite a bit above the standard and it's held pretty steady. And then it looks like it's getting closer and we started to drop that ozone down to what we would hope to be as our national standard. So that's a good sign. Lead, you can see the drastic drop over the years, thank goodness. We did a lot of we start stopped using lead as a vehicle fuel additive. That probably had the largest effect in why we saw large decrease. But notice we see these spikes too, and I'm not sure the reasons for those. We see some other ones, carbon monoxide. We have particulate matter, 2.5 micron versus 10 micron, so different sizes. Nitric oxide and sulfur, or nitrogen dioxide and sulfur dioxide. And notice they've continually dropped as you go from left to right. And where is. Let's go to this page here. So I pulled up, again, EPA website. I wanted to go see what the standards look like now and what the percentages were. And I was able to find it. Here is that same chart. It's kind of more of an interactive chart here. I zoom in a little bit. No, this is okay. So, lead for some reason, a little confusing. They don't have lead values on here until the year 2000, so that's a little odd. But notice lead was a little bit above the standard in 2011. It's this red line here, and it's dropped way, way, way down over since 2010 to 2018, so that's pretty awesome. This green line here's our ozone. So again, we tracked to year 2008 in that other graph, and it's kind of went back up a little bit, but it's been dropping over the years. Pretty much everything again has still been dropping. So 2008 was when that graph stopped, and it looks like everything has dropped, especially sulfur dioxide has plummeted. So that's a good sign. But we do see some raising here. See these from the year 2016? We see some things going back up by quite a bit. So pretty interesting there. In just the past few years, we've seen actually increases. So the opposite. And that has, there's could be a lot of reasons for that. It could be less stringent restrictions. The EPA has been lowering a lot of their rules over the past few years. So we're seeing lower standards for air pollution happening, and we're going to see these rises as a consequence of that. So that is where I'm going to end this first talk. Let's go back up to the first slide here. So again, this was the first key idea that we've looked at today, identifying the major air pollutants and where they come from. Next, we're going to talk about smog. Photochemical smog, rather, there's the photochemical process that goes into making it, and then the acids that are formed in the atmosphere and what the effects those have on the environment. And I will see you guys in the next lecture.